Hello, my lovely anatomists and physiologists. Actually, this week, I'd like to call you my chemists because we are going to be focusing on the chemical level of the human body in our chapter two. So welcome to chapter two video series. Look in your video description for links to the chapter and other study resources. Grab your notebook. Grab your headphones and let's get started. All right, chemists. So why are we being chemists this week instead of just plain old anatomists and physiologists? Because remember, chapter one, we talked about the organization of the human body, and we said that it starts with the chemical level. So we had subatomic particles. We had the atom, we had molecules and compounds. And then that's where we start to see those molecules and compounds making structures inside of the cell, which we called organelles. And then, of course, that takes us to the level of the cell, which remember is our smallest unit of life that's actually alive, right? So subatomic particles, atom, molecule, and compounds, this is what we're talking about in chapter two. So even though it feels like we are being chemists this week, we're still actually being anatomists and physiologists because these are those basic components of our body. What we're talking about then is all of matter. So matter is anything with mass that takes up space. So when we're talking about the chemistry level and we say, okay, these are the basic units that make up our bodies, this is not just limited to our bodies. This is true for our favorite pets. This is true for that beautiful tree growing in your yard. This is true for the soil that that tree is growing in. This is true for the rock that your house is built on. So everything on the planet, anything that has mass, anything that takes up space is classified as matter. So what we're actually talking about here in chapter two isn't limited to the living, okay? When we talk about matter, we will say that it's composed of what we call elements. And elements are going to be called pure substances that cannot be created or broken down by any ordinary chemical means. So elements are pure substances that make up matter. There are 92 elements that have been classified using the periodic table of elements. The periodic table of elements is something hopefully you've seen before in your middle school or high school experience. And it is, of course, showing up in your chapter two. So remember, that's linked in your video description. When we talk about our bodies, we'll see some key elements. So this isn't a complete list, but we'll see oxygen as an example. We'll see carbon. We'll see hydrogen. It's an H there. Just start that one again. And let's see what's another we can list. Nitrogen. That's not complete. We also have chlorine, we have potassium, we have phosphorus, we have quite a few others. Now, how are we getting these elements for our bodies? We're getting them by the food that we eat, by the water we drink, by the air that we breathe. So we're taking these elements out of our environment and using them to construct our bodies. When we talk about an element, we say it's a pure substance. What is that substance? Each element is composed of an atom. So when we talk about atoms, what we're talking about is the smallest unit. Let me say the smallest non-living unit. And this is, of course, composing all of your elements, and your elements are composing your matter, and your matter is anything with mass that takes up space. So at our core, everything on the planet is composed of atoms, and they're all the same kind of atoms. So a carbon atom that's in a tree or coal is the same kind of carbon that's found in your body, right? So that's really cool. When we talk about the atom as the smallest non-living unit, we do have what we're going to describe as subatomic particles. So we have three subatomic particles that we're going to study. We have the proton, which has a positive charge. We have the neutron, which is considered like neutral, no charge. And we have the electron, which is considered to have a negative charge. Now, I always write mine as proton, neutron, and electron, because what we'll see is the proton and the neutron are going to be together housed in the nucleus. Sometimes I'll call it the atomic nucleus, just to kind of differentiate this from a cellular nucleus, which we'll be talking about in chapter 3. When we look at the electron, it's found in a cloud surrounding the nucleus. So we're going to see the electron in what we're going to call an electron shell, or we can call it an electron cloud, or we can call it an electron orbit. Now, if we're truly being just full-on chemists, we're going to be very specific about these definitions. They're going to have slightly different meanings, whether it's a shell, a cloud, or an orbit. But we're only being like kind of chemists, right? Because we're doing this in the context of human anatomy and physiology. And so we don't have to be that particular. So for us, we can think of the shell, the cloud, and the orbit as sort of synonyms, synonymous terms. When we talk about our elements, and we said, if we go back, we said that our elements are pure substances and composed of atoms. How do we know what's making an oxygen atom different from a carbon atom, from a hydrogen atom, or a nitrogen atom? What makes each of these elements different and unique? What sets up the properties for each of those? And the answer to that would be the proton number. So we're going to say the atomic number is the proton number. And it's pretty much like defining what it means to be carbon, what it means to be oxygen, what it means to be nitrogen, and so forth. And you'll see this number on your periodic table of elements. It's usually in the top right-hand corner. Sometimes you might see it written as carbon 6. So here we see the number on the top left-hand side. That's showing out the atomic number. That's telling us that carbon atoms have 6 protons. Okay, so what would that actually look like? So what we can do is do our nucleus. And what I like to do is do 6P. And I can put a little plus sign there to help myself remember. Now, some people will draw 6 plus signs, and that becomes too messy for me, so I don't like to do that. We're going to assume, we're going to draw, let me say, carbon 12. And so now this number here is a number called the atomic mass. And the atomic mass is the number of protons plus the number of neutrons. And so because it's a proton number plus a neutron number, it's a whole number. This is not the number that's published on your periodic table of elements. And for us, we're going to make an assumption that unless there's other information given, our proton number and our neutron number will be the same. So if you have a atomic mass of 12 and you have a proton number of 6, then that tells you you're going to have 6 neutrons, right? 6 plus 6 is 12. Okay, so we are set for our nucleus. Now notice I haven't drawn any kind of circle around that, because if you draw a circle, that can get very confusing later. When we talk about our electrons, they're housed in these spaces surrounding the nucleus, right? And so what we'll see is there's like rules. And your electron orbits are in like layers around the nucleus. So think of an onion. And so we have like the first shell or orbit. This is our innermost. So it's the smallest. It can hold just two electrons. When we go to the next layer, which is called the second shell or orbit, this can hold a total of 8 electrons. And when we go to the third shell or orbit, we see that it can also hold a total of 8 electrons. So these are kind of like the rules of where we're going to find these electrons. Now, this is only drawing elements that are in those first 3 rows of the periodic table. So as you get bigger and bigger, some of those rules change or become more elaborate. And again, if you're being a full-on chemist, you're going to get into that in a general chemistry class. And we are not going to do that in this class. Okay, but what we do need to do is go ahead and finish drawing our carbon. So we said that carbon has atomic number of 6, and that's how we knew how many protons and how many neutrons to put in the nucleus. We made an assumption that the proton number and the neutron number are the same. Well, we're going to make another assumption that the number of electrons is the same. So for us in this course, when we get that atomic number of 6 for carbon, that's going to tell us, okay, 6 protons, 6 neutrons, and 6 electrons. So let's draw that. So you draw your first shell right up there close to your protons and your neutrons. And remember, this first shell can only hold 2 electrons and it's a tiny space. And here's an important piece of information. We need to know that opposite charges attract. Opposite charges attract. And that means then that like charges repel each other. So these negatively charged electrons are supposed to be in this really tiny space together, and they don't want to be close to each other at all. So what we'll see typically is those electrons are drawn across from each other in that first shell. Now, if you want to, you can label it as an electron with a little minus sign, but you don't have to. And in fact, to me, it gets a little bit messy. And so I don't actually like to do that. Now, our carbon atom has 6 electrons and I've drawn 2. And so now that the first shell is full, I need to go ahead and draw my second shell. And so because carbon has 4 electrons left, I'm going to put these in the second shell. And what we're going to do is actually space them across from each other in this particular exact pattern. And then we're done. Okay, so this is an atom of carbon. Let us do one more example. Let us do sodium. Sodium, when we look at our periodic table, has the chemical symbol Na, and it's going to have the atomic number of 11, and it's going to have an atomic mass of 22. So what we can do for sodium is go ahead and draw our 11 protons in the middle and our 11 neutrons. So here I'm representing the nucleus. Okay. Because we're using proton numbers of atomic number of 11, we're going to draw 11 protons, 11 neutrons, and 11 electrons. So what we're going to do next is our first shell, and we're going to fill it in with those 2 electrons that we have. Let's go ahead and draw our second shell. And now we're going to fill in the second shell with our remaining electrons. What I always teach my students to do is to fill in first unpaired electrons and then go back and pair them. Remember, the second shell can just hold 8, so now it's full. And we've drawn 10 electrons, but we need 11. So we actually need to go ahead and draw our third shell. And we have just one electron to put into this space. So here is our atomic structure for sodium. This outer shell has a special name called your valence shell. It's always your outermost. So it doesn't matter if you're drawing hydrogen and helium, which have just a single shell, if you're drawing carbon like we did a minute ago and it has 2 shells, if you're drawing sodium like we've just done and it has 3 shells, or something even bigger, that outermost shell is always called your valence shell. So stay tuned for more information on atomic structure and how we can use that information to help us determine chemical behavior. As always, take care of yourselves and each other.